fight for what you're calling me to. Along with my strength, I got no excuse. Cause broken people are exactly who you use. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. You took a shepherd boy and made him king. So I'm gonna trust you and give you everything. I'll be a conqueror, cause you fight for me. I'll be a champion, claiming your victory. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. I'm gonna stand up, step back when you call. Jesus, Jesus, I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see him fall. I'm gonna stand and step back when you call. Jesus, give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. I'll face my giants with confidence.
And you'll get out, right?
Morning, everyone. We'll just pray. Father, this morning afresh we come into thy presence and we thank you for everyone. We just pray, Lord, still us and still in our minds. We pull down all strongholds, open our hearts and minds and our understanding and our ear, Father, that we would be able to hear your word. And Father, we just pray that Jesus could say the Spirit of the Lord's upon me. We just want to pray the Spirit of the Lord's upon me. His anointing be your preach. Thank you for it. It's good to see everyone. See the title this morning. One thing needful. What are you going to say here? Fellowship above service. What's needful? Fellowship above service. And really, at the end of the day, I've been talking this last wee while there about a couple of weeks about faithfulness. God wants to take and find us faithful. God will put us into the ministry. Just want to read this verse. It's found in 1 Timothy 1:12. You'll find here, I never push anybody, or try to push anybody into anything. See, if the faith shows up, now you can see who can go into things. God's looking and see us faithful. Once the faith comes and faith can be trusted, then you can be trusted maybe with a message. We see this, 1 Timothy 1:12. Now, and I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who enabled me. So who's going to equip you? Who's going to equip you? Spirit of God. Not anything you do. Not anything all these theological colleges and things will do. God's going to enable you to do the call of your life. Right. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. Why was Paul put into the ministry? Because he was found faithful. And I was saying, finding about faithfulness. I was saying right through the whole Bible, there's a golden thread right through the whole thing. It's the word faithful. You know, if you're wanting the pattern in your life, you look at the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the perfect pattern. You know, and see this verse here. Just want you to go, and it's found in Luke chapter 10, verse 38. See, everybody thinks, i.e., if we don't get these people a job, they're going to leave. No, no. You just let God, and I believe I let God, and he'll equip you, and God will open up the door for you. Because that's what's happened in my life. Luke chapter 10, verse 38. Now it came to pass as they went that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. What did Mary do? She sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered. See, when you're a server, you're always cumbered. Martha was cumbered about much serving. Must serve. Must do this. Must do this. Look how many people's coming. I must get this ready. Must get that ready. You know, it's here. There's a whole pile of things to do in here. But wait till this. I'm going to try and just chill out and I'll get done. You know what's here, of that many different things scaling up round with different things to do, but here's what I'm trying to say, and believe it or not, I'm not lackadaisy. I just come to a stage, I'm just going to try and let God's grace give me, equip me, and get people to do these things. And it's the same in your life. Learn to live by peace, and let peace rule your life. And we are here to tell you this, I'm going to try and read this verse, but we tell you this, there'll be certain people in your life and they are cumbered about many things. And all you need to do is pray for them. But listen, and Martha was cumbered about much serving. Okay then. And came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she may help me. And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things, but one thing is needful. And Mary has chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her. One thing, not a whole pile of batch of things. One thing is needful. And Mary chose. And what did Mary choose? Luke 10, verse 39. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. You know this here, even in the Garden of Eden, Adam learned to fellowship with God. In the cool of the day, he went to fellowship, and God fellowship. And know this here, as you just getting in that mode, wait to hear this. You and I have come into relationship by the gospel. But God now wants you to do something more than a relationship. He wants to have fellowship with you. Okay then. If you go, and when you come into that relationship, your spirit's saved. Hebrews 12, verse 23. Now you understand this, there's people that have never heard this before, that their spirit's born again. And then there's other people come along, well, that man's not seeking, is your soul saved? No, your spirit's saved. Hebrews 12, verse 23. And it says this the very last, and to the spirits of just men and women made perfect. Your spirit has been made perfect by the gospel. And there's a wee verse in Matthew 11, come unto me, all ye are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's Matthew 11, verse 28-30. And to all the world today, the Lord's saying, see, the sacrifice is sufficient to save all the world. But listen, not everyone will come. But the Lord's saying this morning, come. You know us here, verse 28, come unto me, Now don't come to me, but come to the Lord Jesus Christ. All ye that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's the spiritual rest of your spirit when you come to Christ. That spiritual rest is given you by you receiving the gospel. Does that make sense there now? You should have inside your mind, if you're born again, you should have inside your spirit, you should have a knowing that your sins are all forgiven. Romans 8, verse 16. Your born again spirit is made alive. Right, Romans 8, verse 16 or 17. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Your spirit, born again spirit, bears witness with the Spirit of God that you are God's child. And all I'm just wanting to show you the verses to back all these up. Now you became God's child by the gospel. And the gospel is, I'll pick one out, Romans 1, verse 16, 17. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew, yes, to the Jew, and to the Greek, and to the Gentiles. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed. God reveals the righteousness of God to the sinner by the gospel. God justifies the sinner. I don't want to get into deep. I just want to try and show you. But listen, you've come into a relationship by the gospel. If you go to 1 John 1. I remember years ago, something I said, the Bible's sticking again. I wrote a sheet out and it says, God wants to have a relationship with you. And it comes by the gospel. But then God wants you to fellowship with him. That comes by you learning to walk in the light. 1 John 1 verse. I'll go to verse 5. This then is the message which we have heard of him. We epistles there. And declare unto you that God is light. And in him is no darkness. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. So you and I must learn not to have a relationship, but learn to how to have fellowship and learn how to walk in the light with God. Okay then, what stops that is you and I not walking in the light, not walking in love. Stops that fellowship. Sorry, I nearly go say it. Doesn't stop the relationship. Stops the fellowship. Right? Now listen now. Verse 7, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, then we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. You know, as you may not think it, most of the body of Christ doesn't know the difference between relationship and fellowship. Right? They think if you don't walk right, you lose relationship. No, if you don't walk right, you can't fellowship. You never lose your relationship if you come God's way. But you see, if you go to Matthew 11 again, Matthew 11, verse 28-30. In this relationship with God now, went to Luke, Matthew 11, verse 28-30. These same verses says there, come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's the rest for your spirit. You're born again. But you know this here, in this fellowship, you'll find out that your soul weighs you down with different problems and different situations. And if you don't learn how to, i.e. yield yourself and yoke yourself to Christ, you're always going to have a problem in your soul realm. And that's why it causes you that you can't walk in fellowship with God the way God wants you to do. Right, go you to me, look at, Matthew 11, 29. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. See, this morning, if you're going to fellowship, you're going to have to learn to come and follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Take his yoke. It's in red writing. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. So this rest is not given, this rest is found. But it's only found for those who take my yoke and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and you find rest for your soul. See, Martha hadn't any soul rest. She was weighed down, encumbered. And then all these problems in life, they really show us that we have a problem in our soulish realm, for the emotions go haywire when all these issues come in. But listen to this verse again. Take my yoke. And years ago, as a young Christian, I started to see how God wanted me and how God wanted to fellowship with me. And I had to learn by God's... And I've seen this verse here. The Lord wanted me to take his yoke. And I started to follow the Lord. And everybody else was telling me different things. But I've seen from Scripture, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am lowly of heart, and you will find rest for your soul. Take my yoke, and I started to look at the Lord's life, and I learned by the Lord's life the pattern, what to do and follow. And this morning, I would like to show you, if you're going to learn to fellowship, you're going to have to look at the Lord, look to the Lord, and look at the Lord. And you'll see things in his life, that how he fellowshiped with God. Now, by the way, we have church out here, and church wants you to serve. And could I tell you this? Most of us, if you go in that direction, you'll not get this. But this verse is saying here, there's two rests. One's given, the other must be found. If you never find soul rest, you will stay on Martha. But Mary found this rest. We'll read it again. Take my yoke upon you, and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest for your soul. Now, when you find rest for your soul, for my yoke is easy and my burden's light. See, when you look at the Lord's yoke is so easy and it's so light. And if you find you're struggling, by the way, you're probably not at peace and at rest. Honestly, it's the same. I'm going to say something here. There's nobody in here or probably online has as many problems as I have. My life, my family, everything else. I wouldn't like to think they have anyway. But listen to this here. I have none. And I get laughed at when I say that. I have none of these problems. Because they're not mine. And I learned the Lord's my caretaker. I learned from him. Casting all your care upon him. And I say that. But see, I know that. I'm not saying that for to sound good. I mean, I learned the Lord through that relationship of fellowship with God and the Lord Jesus Christ. I learned the Lord's my caretaker. I.e. church out here. No. We have a different system. We have counsellors. We have all this other stuff. And all I'm just saying to you is, you will never find that soul rest. I could take you through circumstances in my life, and people even say to me, still, how are you fit to go through them things? Why does them things not flash back in you? The Lord takes care of all this stuff. And that's how I learned. I learned in this walk with God, and I learned about the Lord. He is everything to me. And I learned the Lord's my caretaker. And I learned now, if I pick this stuff up, I have went back again, and I have to say, Lord, pick this up again. And I can go over these things, but what you say this, and ye shall find rest unto your soul. I read it, find rest for your soul. No, it doesn't say that. And ye shall find rest unto your soul. You know this here, this doesn't sound like, I've been told before now, live in the real world. But listen, this, honestly, this works. I'm just thinking of a verse, and it's in Genesis 41. 42. Genesis 41. I don't want to go into all the situations, how this came about. A certain counsellor came to me one day and says, I have a problem in my life. You're going to have flashbacks and you need to go and talk to a counsellor. And I says, well, why would I need to go and talk to a counsellor? Because all them things that's happened to you, you're going to have flashbacks. And it's going to affect you mentally if you don't have an outlet to talk. And I goes to the Lord and says, I say, Lord, why is this stuff now coming and flashback and annoying me? Make sure the Lord showed me. Genesis 41, verse 51. And Joseph called the name of his firstborn son Manasseh, for God said, he hath made me forget all my toil and all my father's house. God caused me to forget all them situations. God can cause you to forget all them situations and all them problems and all the things you're going through. How does he do it? Genesis 41, verse 51 and 52. God caused me to... Joseph, this is Joseph here. Why did God cause Joseph to forget? And that's what he called the name of Manasseh. Manasseh means forget. God caused me to forget. See, in the world out there, there is no cure for all these problems and all these situations. You have to live with it, but you have to forgive. Now, God can make you forget. Please. I'm not telling you the whole situation for up too long. I learned the Lord's my caretaker. He only causes me to forget because I give it to him. See, when I say that, honestly, we don't have a... See, you can either be cumbered and weighed down with a situation, or you can get a revelation that the Lord's your caretaker and he wants to fellowship with you and he wants you to take all that to him. But religion out here wants to tell you that they have other programs. Now we hear the next verse. And the name of the second called he Ephraim, for God has caused me to be fruitful. We hear this. The Lord caused me to forget, and the Lord has caused me to be fruitful in the land of my affliction. Please, I can literally tell you tonight that my God is so faithful that that's exactly what he's done for me. And that's what he wants to do for you. And it's in that fellowship. You may not think it, but you don't understand. Listen, you don't understand what I've gone through. And listen, all I'm just saying to you is, that's what God wants to do. This is not a sort of like, try this for so many days and see how this works. It's not a pseudo thing. In other words, an old false thing to try. This is the real thing here. But listen to this here. Go back to Matthew 11, verse 28 and 29 or 30 again. Come unto me, all ye are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Listen, my destiny for heaven sorted. My spirit saved. I possess all things in my spirit. I don't need to get any more. I have everything. The problem is, I need the work done in my soul to get and how to access all the blessings that God has done for me. I never knew any of this stuff, but all I'm just saying is, now wait to see if I can show you this. If I can show you this a wee bit. I'll read this again, for I like this verse, Matthew 11. And years later on in my Christian life, I found soul rest. And I was able to take everything, as the Lord showed me, and I was able to take and give everything. And a lot of people that know me and all the circumstances that happened in my life, a girl said to me no sooner than a month ago, I can't understand how you're fit to get through this. I said, and I told her in front of everybody, so the Lord has caused me to forget all this stuff. See, that's a great testament. The Lord's done this. And then I quoted the verse of the Bible to her. Well, it says, Matthew 11, we hear this, the Lord wants to do the same for you. The Lord doesn't want you weighed down like Martha. The Lord wants you to be chilled out and enjoy life and learn to hand and fellowship and hand everything to him. Matthew 11, verse 20, Luke 29, take my yoke upon you. I can't take it for you. I can only take it for me. And learn of me. And I start to look, and I start to read and look at the Lord's life. Right. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and you will find, ye shall find. That AV says personally, the person that's looking will find. Unto your soul. Okay. For my yoke is easy and my burden's light. If I could say one thing this morning, see to walk with the Lord, it's life changing. And it's so easy. You see, religion, my God, that's hard work. That's hard work. But listen, for years after I got saved, I lived religion. And then I learned about this fellowship. One thing is needful, learning how to fellowship. And see, in that circumstance, and I don't want to go all these problems, all the things, all them verses, and I could sit here and show you all these verses, but I just want to show you another thing. If you go to Romans chapter 12, verse 1, and see, we church have set up a pile of programs and different things, and it looks as if it's working. But listen, I think Mel said a thing that says, I think it's a hymn, I've tried the broken sisters, Lord, but all the waters fail. See, all these other sisters, they fail. How about we hate to try them? No, but they fail. I've tried the broken sisters, Lord, but all the waters failed. See, the one here never fails. Romans 12, verse 1. And years ago I seen this, verse 11. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. This is truly the way to worship God. Give your bodies, soul, mind, heart, to God. For this is truly the way to worship him. This is talking about yielding yourself to God. The other one was yoking your soul to God. All to God, and yoking and come into soul rest. This is what you really need, is yielded and yoked. Right? Romans chapter 6. Maybe some of the people don't like it. NIV, Romans 6. This teaching should be spoke at water baptism. You've got saved. Now God wants us, because of our conscience, to have a good heart and conscience and get baptized. Romans 6, verse 15. Romans 6 verse 1 to 15 would talk about know what happened the night you get saved. Don't you know that all of us were baptized into Christ? That's verse 3. You were baptized into his death. And this is the NIV read. So then verse 8, now if we died with Christ, we believe that we also live with him. And some of the verses will tell you this, knowing this. 6 or 7. For we know that our old self was crucified with him. AV says no, knowing this. And then it says this, and this is a different version I've picked up. And it says this then, reckon yourself to be dead. That's Romans 6 verse 1 to 15 I'm talking about here. Reckon you died with Christ. Now, yield yourself. Romans 6, maybe. I'll read the NIV. Do not offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourself to God as those who have been brought from the dead to life, and offer the parts of your body to him as instruments of righteousness. You have a free will. God cannot override your free will, even though your spirit's saved. So listen to this here. This is Willie Spratt. You're doing your own thing. Unless you're yielded to God. But God wants you to yield to him. And when you do that, you put your soul, body, members, heart, everything to God. What are you going to do here? Now you've left yourself out, you haven't a free will anymore. Now you're under the control of the Spirit of God. You hear what I said there now? Before that, you're not under the control. The Spirit of God lives in you, but the Spirit of God has no control of you. I'm only talking my own life. I struggled with different areas and different things and hobbies and idols. And I didn't know anything like that. And I could not break them. And all of a sudden one night I read that. And I offered what I'm telling you, everything to God. Supernaturally, God broke the desires of that hobby of my life. And I've never had them desires again. For I choose to walk away and not go that road. I couldn't break it. I tried everything. I couldn't break it. I used to say to my wife, I'm going to stop these. No, I couldn't. But I realised when God had a free will and I gave him away, God supernaturally broke it. Now, we can show you this. Romans 6, verse 15. I'm going to read this. It was the NIV I read this night. What then? Shall we sin because we're not under the law, but under grace? By the way, we're not under the law. We're under grace. The law was given. Let me show you this when I'm here. Luke 16, verse 16. I don't want to go from one of my trances. Luke 16, verse 16. I was at a 50 party last night, not a party, a 50-year-old anniversary. Luke 16, the law and the prophets were unto John. When was the law and the prophets? John the Baptist. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached. So we're under the kingdom of God now. Hopefully I get this right. Look, Matthew 11. Verse 12 and 13. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied unto John. All the Bible and all the prophets prophesied unto John. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached. So we're in the kingdom. We're not under the law. We're under grace. Now them spiritual laws there. Right. Romans 6. Right. What then? Shall we sin because you're not under the law, but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one to whom you obey? Whether you're slaves to sin, which leads to death, or your obedience, which leads to righteousness. Wait here, I said here. Lord, I present my, I give everything to you. And see the NIV that night. I learned a thing. When I offered myself, my body, my members, my will, my free will, this led me to God producing a righteous life in me. Read it again. You're righteous in your spirit by believing the gospel. Now this is righteousness in your soul. Romans 6, verse 16. Don't you know that when you offer yourself to someone to obey, as slaves, you are slaves to the one you obey? Well, I have never offered myself to obey God. Well, then you're a slave to your own nature. And that's why you have the problems. But I want to do my own thing. Well, that's okay. Well, you'll get the results. If you sow to the flesh, you'll have flesh reap corruption. Where? Galatians 6. You'll always get results. I remember I used to work to a man, he worked his righteousness to his word. And he was always, results, results. But Galatians chapter 6. If I can find it. Do not be deceived, verse 7. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, him shall he reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he to the Spirit shall reap life everlasting. Now we have never told the body of Christ, maybe as plain as that. And all I'm just saying to you is I get a revelation and I yield everything to the Spirit of God. And I give up my free will and I come under the will of God. My body, my mind, my members, everything. Supernaturally, God broke the desires of all them things off my life. And just look over, phew, they're gone. Now, what's this? I'll try and read this. Verse 17. But God, thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, your wholeheartedness obeyed the form of teaching to which you were entrusted. See, the apostles came along and taught that to the believers here. And the apostle teachers should be allowed to teach that to believers today. And that's what made the transformation in these people's lives. Now, what's this again? But thank be to God that you, though you used to be slaves to sin, verse 17, Romans 6, this is NIV, you wholeheartedly obeyed that form of teaching to which you were entrusted. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. Now, that's personal righteousness. That's not positional righteousness, the righteousness you got by the gospel. This is personal righteousness. And God will now do a personal righteousness work in this believer, because this believer has given him the right to do it. Now, I want to read next verse. Right, verse 19. I put this in human terms, because you are weak in your natural selves, just as you used to offer your parts of your body in slavery to impurity and to increasing wickedness, so now you offer them in slavery to righteousness, leading to holiness. So this personal righteousness that God will do in you will lead you to holiness. We hear him go say here, I have 6 books on there about holiness. There's the way to holiness. Presenting your body, presenting your members, yielding everything. God has now the right to do a sanctification work in your soul, which will lead you to holiness and will lead you to how to fellowship with God. That God will be able and enable you to bring everything about in your life for the call of your life. We hear him going to say here, I learned 3 wee phrases. There's such a thing as coming under the control of the Spirit. And then you're able to hear the counsel of the Spirit. Now stay under the covering of the Spirit, and God will bring everything about in your life. For he has the right now to do this. What's the time like? 12:05. And see, in my own life, I started just to follow the Lord. Let me show you a wee verse. The first I got that night was Mark 1 verse 17. Mark 1 verse 17. I told you about the soul resting, just wait a second, and then verses. Then I read this one night. I was at a meeting one night, a gospel meeting, and this is what it says. And Jesus said unto him, come ye after me. So you've come to Christ. Come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. What will God make you to become? Who will he make to become? The ones who come after him. The ones who are yielded. The ones who are yoked in soul rest. Now that's the work God will do. I'm not sending you in a program here. I'm sending you to a person. And he will do this work in you. Does that make sense there? Now that's the way the Lord taught his early disciples. Now if you go to Matthew 4 verse 19. Matthew 4 verse 19. And I have to be very careful with what I say here. But here's what I learned. I didn't realise this, but I was following men before. But I was following what they were saying, not checking it out. Or maybe not having the discernment to understand what I was doing. Let's read this verse, Matthew 4 verse 19. And he said, follow me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. And I got a revelation, the Lord wants me to follow him. Well, here I'm going to say here. If I write this out, up here I could write, follow me. A lot of people maybe not like what I'm going to write here. Jesus says, follow me. Well, wait, you hear what I was doing. I was following men. The Lord says to me, drop the end. And listen what it says here. Then I thought myself, well, and I heard the call of God. That night the man spoke them verse in Mark 1 verse 17. Lord, how am I going to do this? And how am I going to do this? And I heard the call of God. How am I going to bring the call of God about? Then I got a revelation. And 10 months later I read this verse again. Mark 1 verse 17. And it just dropped into my spirit. We hear this. Jesus said unto them, come ye after me, and I will make you to become. I will make you to become whatever I want you to be. And you talk about a weight lifting off me. There's a weight just lifted off my back. See here this morning, I didn't get very much time to study last night. After all things, and I come down this morning. But wait till yes, all I'm just saying to you is, listen, God will make you to become. You don't have to go and serve for man to make you something. Please, if you're serving, stop it. Yoke and yield and let the Lord put your serving in your life. And you look back and you will be totally amazed when you see God, what he does in you. Listen to this verse. Right. God wants to do a work in your spirit. No. He's done that work by the gospel. He wants to do a work in your soul. And as you learn in that work in your soul, you're going to learn to fellowship with him. And you're going to learn to take everything and go with him and with everything. And you're going to learn to live by peace. And when, and listen, I learned this in my own life. If I haven't peace, I'm not doing this. And I found out the peace of God there is there to arbitrate and make every decision in your life. Colossians 3 verse 15. By the way, when you have no peace, you'll find out you'll have no fellowship. But now on, go back. You have a relationship, but you'll find that you, at that moment in time, you have no fellowship. If you run a bit, you've lost your peace. Colossians, and see if you ever get the peace of God. You know us here, you will hunger and desire if you step outside the peace to be back in him. Colossians 3 verse 15. Colossians 3 verse 15. And let the peace of God rule your heart. Meet you next wee bit, to which you're also called. And I got a revelation years ago. Meet you here, I'm going to do. I put this into practice. I am doing nothing unless I have peace. I'm doing nothing. Excuse me. People used to ask me to go to a whole pile of meetings, and I would have went. And you know us here, I was a bit like Martha, running about. And all of a sudden, as I seen this, and people come and ask me, Would you want to go such and such? And I says, listen, I'm going to stay here. If I don't go, I'm going to ask the Lord. If I've no peace, I'm not going. Not one person ever come back to me and ask me why I never went. I always let the peace of God rule everything. And I found that is the Holy Spirit having the right to umpire your life. And do not be ashamed, no matter who comes to you. Listen, I pray for the rest of my days, Lord, help me to make every decision and live by your peace. What's that? Colossians 3, verse 15. And let the peace of God rule. Now that word there is umpire or arbitrate. Now listen, what time is it? You're in a cricket match and you're batting the ball, and all of a sudden the ball goes and a fielder catches it. And the catcher says, you're out. Okay, and you say, that ball hit the ground first. How do you sort that out? You go to the umpire. Umpire says, out. Well, whether you like it or not, you have to march. Because the umpire says you're out. The peace of God umpires everything. Makes every decision. Everything financially. Everything. Relationship-wise. Everything. Every decision in your life. Whether you want to go to buy something or something, you ask the peace of God. And if you've no peace, don't you go. For the peace of God is telling you, hold on, man, there's something wrong here. And more you get conscious of listening to the peace of God, the more and more you will walk in the Spirit of God. Right? See, if you go to Philippians chapter... See, here's what it is. We don't listen to the peace of God, and then we come into all these situations, and then everybody else comes to analyse the thing. You haven't been taught to live by the peace of God. And do not override the... Please listen. I'm an uncle to a wee young fella in Scotland. And I was At the wedding, I was speaking at the wedding. He went to Scotland. 2 years later, he split up, and someone in my spirit rung him up one day. And I didn't know anything about this, and he rung up and he started breaking down and crying. So, what's wrong with you? Me and Carly's broke up. I says, right, what are you crying about? He says, you come up and you taught us, him and the two sisters, I told them as a young Christians, never ever override the peace of God. He says, I override the peace of God. I said, what do you mean you override the peace of God? 2 weeks before I was about to get married, the Lord told me not to get married. And I never listened. That young fella's in Scotland today. He sees his way in. The child he had to the girl. He moved into another relationship. She's not saved. She has a mental issue. He's broke down now with a mental illness himself. Was that God's path for him? No. He overrided God's peace. Now, I'm not saying anything. He broke down and cried his eyes out. He says, I never listened to you. And you told me never let anything do anything without peace. Wait, you see, that's Philippians chapter 4. This is how to learn to fellowship. Living by the peace of God. In yielded and soul rest. Never worry what anybody else thinks. Please. Because you know why? The fear of man brings a snare. You learn to follow the Lord and follow his peace. Wait, I'll show you this wee verse. Philippians chapter 4. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God that passes all understanding will keep your hearts and minds. What will the peace of God do? It will keep your heart and your mind. See, for be careful for nothing. See, Martha was weighed down with everything. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, take all your problems to the Lord. See, so be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplications, let your requests be made known to God. We hear this. I remember saying this years ago. If you do part A, God will do part B. So what's part A? Be anxious, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplications, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. That's part A. What's God's part? And the peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your heart and your mind. See, the peace of God, it passes all understanding and what everybody else tells you. It will keep your heart and minds through Christ Jesus. So I'll ask you a question. Do we need the peace of God? Yes. The peace of God is there to guard your heart. See that word mind on there? It's a word in the Greek called Naoma. And every time that Naoma word, the peace of God, I learned to let the peace of God rule my, and I never knew this for years. And I found out the mind in there is a word called Naoma, and it's Satan coming attacking your mind. And Satan can't get attacking the mind of the one who's living under the peace of God. And every time that word mind and Naoma is mentioned, I'll maybe be able to pick one up, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. It's called Naoma in the Greek. And it is a, forget the name of the word. It's like a thing on a computer there, and it blocks, it's a program that stops the attack of virus and come into the computer. That's the same with this. And next thing it's found in 2 Corinthians 4 verse 4, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds, in whom the God of this world has blinded the Naomi's. Of this world, the mind of this world. Satan comes and blinds the minds. Satan can't blind your mind or your heart. If you've learned to be anxious for nothing, you learn to give everything to the Lord Jesus Christ. peace of God will guard your heart and mind. And we hear the words come into my mind here. In the Greek, it's a word called in the vine's device. It's a device that comes in and guards your heart, your mind, and your life, if you let the peace of God arbitrate it. Colossians 3, verse 15. Now that's how you're going to learn how to fellowship. And letting God do these things, and now you're yoked, now you're yielded, and the peace of God is starting to rule and reign. We hear this, I will make you to become. See, I get a revelation of this. I was down in Portrush years ago, and I was walking down. How is this ever going to work? How am I ever going to get this call of God in my life to work? And all of a sudden, I was walking down Port Stewart Beach, and this gospel tract went by me, and I put my foot on it. You maybe heard me on here saying, but listen to this here. 2 Thessalonians. Sorry, it's 1 Thessalonians. Verse 5, verse 23. And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. So God wants to do a sanctification work in you completely. Your spirit's already sanctified. I pray that your whole spirit, which is already sanctified, soul and body, be preserved blameless unto the coming of the Lord. What does God want to do with your soul and body? He wants to preserve it blameless and do this work in you. And I read in Romans 6, it's leading into holiness. We hear the next verse. Faithful is he that calls you, also will do it. We hear him going to say, hey, the Lord says to me, Willie, you have yielded everything. I'm going to bring that into your life. Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. And it's God has done it, not me. But I give him the right to do it. And see, and when I done that, let me tell you this, it didn't look too good for a lot of things I was doing wrong. The Lord said, stop this. Stop being cheeky your wife. And maybe still doing the same. Stop this. And it's this sanctification work that God has the right to do that he's going to do in you. And he wants you to be found faithful. And we tell you this, he will enable you and put you into his ministry. Watch this, I'll try and show you this. I read the verse earlier on there. Well, I'll read it again. 1 Timothy 1, verse 12. We hear him go say here, preparation time is not wasted time. The greatest thing in my life, if I tell you tonight, is learn to wait on God. A lot of people say to me, you should be doing this and you should be doing that. Say, how long, man? What does the Lord think? I says, wait to see what the Lord does. No, honestly, I know what you think of me, but wait till I, at the minute, I hopefully don't go ahead of God. 1 Timothy 1, verse 12. And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who enabled me. Who enabled Paul? Why did God enable him? Because he gave him the right. Please. And when you give God the right, God has the right to come in and do this work. And we have been taught, if we're really honest, we have been taught to serve. And we have been taught to do all these things. And we hear this, even you go to church, well, you need to go and lead the law and the prophets. And you need to study all that stuff. And what does John, what is the verse I read, Luke 16, verse 6, the law and the prophets are up to John. No, study the kingdom. Follow the king. Let the Lord, study grace. And see the Lord enabling your life and empowering your life. Now watch this, I'll try and show you this. I've showed you most of them things, but I just want to show you one maybe other thing here. Right. As you learn to follow the Lord, believe it or not, you learn to fellowship with the Lord. Okay? By the way, could I tell you this? Most of us who are serving will not get this. For we'll not let go serving. For we're following other programs and our heart's not open. For our heart's only open to what everybody else will tell us. And that's why you need a good open heart and listen to this here, and God, a fully committed heart to follow the Lord. I want to show you a verse. It's found early on in my Christian life, one day I come in. I decided, I had a Bible in here, and I say one day I walked over the Bible. And the new way you automatically open the Bible is found in Proverbs 23, verse 26. And I felt the Lord speaking that day. That day, this the Lord says to me, Proverbs 23, my son, give me thine heart. See, this morning, the Lord wants your heart. If the Lord gets your heart, well, what will he show you? What will he do? Next verse, next wee bit. And let thine eyes observe my ways. Give me your heart, and then your eyes can follow my ways. See, the rest of the meeting, I just want a couple of wee things. I'm not going to go over it too much time. I seen and found out the one with the perfect pattern was the Lord Jesus Christ, the perfect servant. And for 3 years I just studied the Lord's life. You could not do better than just follow the Lord and look at the Lord's life. And you ask here, if you go to Philippians, well, go to the new level, Philippians chapter 2, you'll read a lot of qualities that the Lord had. He was the perfect servant. But he was something else. He was the obedient servant. And he was another thing. He was the faithful servant. Philippians chapter 2. Right. Verse 5. You, New Leaven. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience. I've written here, to God. And it says it in here. He humbled himself in obedience to God. Right? And this wee bit says here, and died on the criminal's, and died a criminal's death on the cross. No, we hear, I see none of this. He humbled himself in obedience. God didn't humble him. You ever said there? God will never humble you. You lift yourself up, and a spiritual law will come into action. You will be brought low. But you humble yourself and you will be exalted. That's a spiritual law. We are putting people in to serve and we don't realise what we're doing. We are wrecking most of them people's lives because we're pushing them out to serve and the humility's not there. And later on in their life, they're going to, that spiritual law will come into their lives. And they will be brought low. Not in Jesus' part here. We hear this for verse 9. Therefore God elevated him to the place of highest honour. Everyone, I'll read a couple of verses here and I'm finished. You don't want to go there, please. Huh? No. Sometimes, you know, it's easier just to say very little. But you know, think of the young fella in Scotland, and I told him, do not override the peace of God. You must hear, his dad come to me, he's my brother, and he said to me, what has happened to that buddy? Nobody knows, but I'll tell you this, he didn't listen to the peace of God. But here's the sad thing. He was hearing the peace of God because he knew he hadn't listened to the peace of God, and he comes on the phone to me breaking down and crying, I never listened to you. As he started crying his eyes out, what do you mean? I knew the peace of God and I never listened. And all I'm just saying to you is, see that spiritual law? That spiritual law works in everything. You and I do not listen to the peace of God going to finish. I could read them other verses and say there's other verses in there, but I just want to pray. Father, we turn this morning. Father, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, the perfect servant and the perfect pattern. Father, may we hear your voice and follow your peace and learn to fellowship with you, Father, like Mary, sitting at your feet, hearing your word. And Father, may we hear your counsel and follow you and stay under your covering. And may the body of Christ this morning, Father, get a revelation. We're not here to be served. We're here to learn to fellowship with you, Father. And then you do everything in our lives. Father, we just pray for the body of Christ this morning. We pray for ones, loved ones, of people who've maybe gone home. And Father, we just pray that the Holy Spirit would have access into every one of your children, Father, this morning. And we pray, Lord, that everyone will come under the control of the Spirit of God. And Father, may be able to hear your counsel and stay under your covering. And Father, we thank you that you're going to do a marvellous work in each one of us. And Father, we just pray we take authority over principalities and powers and we bind them. And we pray God's peace and God's fullness to rest on each one and each home. In the name of the Lord Jesus, amen.